dapat ang isang AFP chief bilang siya yung namumuno sa sandatahang lakas ng ano ng ating bansa. Syempre dapat isinasaalang-alang niya muna, pinaka primarya sa kanyang mga interes ay yung lipo ng kanyang pinaglilingkuran. Kailangan hindi niya inuuna yung kanyang mga pansariling pangailangan, kanyang mga pansariling interes.
Ang mga katangian na gawin ng AFP chief ay kailangan ipaglaban ng mga karapatan ng tao, maging tapat sa konstitusyon at walang takot kahit ano man yung dumaan sa kanilang paghihirap sa mga problema.
Welcome back. Our question, what for you are the best qualities of an AFP chief? You've heard most of the comments. Still more comments from Philip J. To see or know about corruption and to fail to take action is also being corrupt. So Oban must act quickly. From Janice Paulino, dapat siguro mabigyan din ng pagkakataon ng mga sundalo na makapiling ng itatalagang AFP chief through voting kasi more than anybody else, isa sila sa nakakakilala ng mga background ng mga general to get the inputs of the sundalo.
Mahirap na,
para magkaroon sila ng popularity
idol
contest.
The military is not a democracy.
Yes,
as an institution, correct. It's not a democracy. Yeah. Or else you'll endanger lives.
Yes,
military is not a democracy. Yeah. From Din Guzman of Cagayan, the AFP chief of staff should have the respect of the AFP officers and the Filipino people, but we don't know him. I mean, this is just the only time we're getting to know him, so how he must earn the respect of the Filipino people. From Giorgio Velasco of Naga City, the AFP chief should not be under the saya.
I agree.
No, but it was also noteworthy as watching General Oban speak, introduced his wife.
But
twice.
They always do that.
But they always do that. But he introduced his parents in his mother-in-law, I think. And they always do that.
Yeah.
In fact, we were counting the length of time they spoke, and it was just maybe 50% of the time was a portion set aside for saying thank you.
Well, it's always like that.
It's always like
it's
that.
It's always been like
it's
that.
It's always like that. Yeah. But this
nobody
one
ever just cuts it short and says, you know, good morning, hello to everyone, then start with the speech.
Yeah, but I found this, the portion that I found in General Oban's speech that struck me was that I am going to be accountable.
But they
I
all
mean,
should
he,
be
he,
anyway.
He said, he, no, but for you to declare it, I've never heard anybody say that I will be accountable. He says, I will be responsible, I hope I can accomplish this, but he says, I am going to be accountable, you know. Is that macho enough?
Well, no, I think he was trying to be forceful and confident because people know that he just has a limited time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's this issue of the revolving door practice. And at the same time, it's in light of what's been going on, the corruption scandal.
Yeah.
So I think he had to come out and say something. And that was his way of assuring the public, I guess, that it's going to be okay with me.
President,
you know.
What struck you most about what he said? Or what he did not say?
No, for me, it's the sweep of reforms that he wants to undertake.
Okay.
Because it's not realistic. So again, maybe he could have just chosen one or two. Because he really said a great deal about reforms. Reforming the AFP, implementing the Feliciano Commission recommendations, strengthening the procurement process. So for me, I said, wow, we'd really love to see all of this happen. But, you know, can they really have
But does he have an organization that can also catch up if he at all is multitasked and can accomplish as what he said? I mean, can the organization, Cris, live up to all of the things that he set for himself to do?
If they're all efficient, yes. Yeah. If he has a good staff, if the offices are all efficient, if they all do their work at the right time. They can do it properly.
They can.
Well, I just don't know how long, but if they're all efficient, if all the staffs, I mean all members of the J staff are efficient.
Is the implementing area the J staff?
Well, that's the command structure of the
Armed
Forces.
Tell us how it works, yeah.
to accomplish all that he said he would accomplish in 9 months. The implementing units or the groups are the J.
It's the J staff, but I think I'm not quite sure how he wants to go about it. I don't know if he wants to have a separate office. I don't know if he wants just his office handling it, or if he wants the entire J staff to do it. That I don't know.
How do you think your dad?
I think within nine months he can accomplish significant reforms, but he would just have to focus specifically on this issue that was raised, generals dipping into the funds of the AFP. And it couldn't be at a more appropriate time, because in a few months, the Defense Department, the whole bureaucracy, would be submitting its budget proposal to Congress. And there would be budget hearings, appropriations hearings. And I think that's where the reform could be done, because out of the hearings that have transpired, what I see that the AFP needs to do is reform its system so that there would be less opportunities for abuses, and at the same time, address the operational necessities of the troops on the ground. Because conversion, the system of conversion, was born out of necessity. Of shortcutting the red tape.
So they said just, that they have found a way of not doing any conversion already at this point.
Well, apparently there are still loopholes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, for example, with the UN funds. In the hearings, it turned out that there is no accountability with regard to the funds released by the United Nations. The UN basically turned over the funds to the AFP without expecting any audit report or some measure of auditing how it is spent. That's why there was a discretion and leverage to use those funds for personal gain. So I think in that 9 months that he has now, especially the timing, he can achieve significant reforms, but he would just have to focus on those specific reforms.
Okay, that's his. What about you, Marites? Where do you want him to focus, or what do you think is the most important thing?
I really agree with former Congressman Biazon. It's really the budget of the AFP. I remember in 2005 when General Abu became chief of staff, he dismantled the controller's office and set up four offices so that there'd be checks and balance. Mm. Maybe General Oban can tell us how this has, I mean, at least tell the public how this has worked and maybe improve on that. And making the budget really go to the field, because it used to be, a lot of it used to be with general headquarters. Mm. So most of it should be with the field. And what's the process? Maybe he should just make it more effective.
Mm-hmm. Cris, having known General Oban amongst all of us, is he the right man to lead the armed forces
at this
time?
You've asked me that question
two times. Yes, because I want to see whether you have the same answer on my third try.
Let's wait and see. But yes, I would say that, you know, I mean,
from among those that have been interviewed, from the 10 that have been submitted by General David, was he the only man?
The only one?
The only man
I think
deserving of the chief of staff
that's
position?
That's the thing. It really depends on the priority of the president, and he's the commander-in-chief. That's what I wanted to say earlier. As commander-in-chief, you know, this isn't just a question of who the chief of staff is. This is a question of the president's prerogative as commander-in-chief, because he's the one basically running the army. So people will look up to that. They'll have to see what he has, what vision he has for the armed forces. And, you know, if now it looks like, well, my Secretary of National Defense is there, I'm comfortable with him because he was my mother's chief of the Presidential Guard. I'm happy. I know he can put, you know, things in order. I just want to be confident that everything will be okay. People will see it as, you know, the secretary running things for him. But it's different if they feel that he's the one running the armed forces. And that's important. I mean, some officers...
The president.
Yes.
Yeah.
So some people are saying, well, you know, we're kind of happy because he's really open about modernizing the armed forces, because basically the modernization plan has just, you know, come and gone. You know, they haven't really reached that stage where you can say the armed forces is what it is for external defense.
So you're saying now that it's now President Aquino.
He's the commander-in-chief.
He's the commander-in-chief, and his selection of General Oban, or his choice of General Oban, actually showed to all of us how he, the president, wants to lead the armed forces.
Yes, basically it comes
more
down
than how
to that.
General Oban is going to take orders from him.
Well, I think it's important if he chose General Oban. A while ago, Marites and I were talking about, you know, why he says it is not a revolving door thing. Uh-huh. But if people see it as a revolving door policy, then, you know, they get a little bit worried about that. Mm-hmm. So it's important for the president to show what he really wants his army to be, his armed forces.
And you've seen that. Okay. That's all the time we have, and I'd like to tell you that Cris Yabes here has got, I think, her fifth book, and this one is Peace Warriors. You go read it. I started browsing, and very familiar because it's just for the past 10 years.
10 years?
10 years of
Mindanao?
Maybe 2 less years.
2 years.
Yeah, last two years. Yeah.
Okay, that's all the time we have. Marites, it's always good to see you.
Thank you, Tina.
Thank you very much. And
thank
Cris
you.
Yabes, maraming salamat.
Thank you.
It's nice to see you after all these years. And of course, Congressman, former Congressman Rufi Biazon, are you going to be assuming a position one of these days?
I don't know.
I think you are. That's all the time we have. Talk to us again next week on Talkback.